Aryan, share your CV to me in WhatsApp. Yeah. And we have uploaded all the presentations in Box Drive so far, including today's 4 presentations are available in Box Drive in a stage 2 folder, probably, or series 2, like that it will be mentioned. There will be a subfolder in Box Drive, so you can download the presentations from there. Vamsi Anna Pragada, this name also is very familiar, Vamsi. Nilakant Thakur, Bhanu Teja, yeah, Bhanu Teja, Varshit Vallala, all are known to me. You come so regularly. Good morning to you all. Varshit Vallala, you're also regular, Varshit. Mallikarjun Boenpalli, yeah, regular attendee, Mallikarjun. Good morning. Anand Dave, you're also regular, sir. Good morning. Sayed Mujail Yusuf Sayed. Yeah, welcome. Good morning. Maqsood Khan. Abdul Majid. Yeah, some may not be. Karthikeyan Murugesan. Subramaniam. Good morning. Nilakant Thakur. Yeah, let's see. I wish I can accommodate all civil engineers in our country. The God should give me that opportunity. That's why I'm working. I created a Telegram group and I'm working to get the engineers bill enacted. Yeah, Facebook, it is there, Shreyas Patel. You can see it will be pinned. It is a pinned post, actually, Telegram link. Both in LinkedIn, Facebook, it is available. Anyway, if you don't find, I'll post it today again. Hi, Ravindra. Engineer Rajit Kumar. Subramaniam, today happens to be my birthday as per Telugu calendar. Gautam Chaurasia. Yeah, thank you, Prashant. You should wish me in Telugu, yeah. Today is Telugu birthday, Telugu calendar. Thank you, Gautam. Yogesh Sate, thank you. Abhilash. Shavendra Kole. Sheer Sagarji. Gaurinath, welcome. Good morning to you. We'll start in another 1 minute. Good morning, sir. Thank you, Rangasatam, sir. Sadanandam Dampeti, thank you. Anandave, thank you. Thank you, Prashant. Vinit Kumar Reddy, thank you. Telugulo Jepparu. Danyunni. Yeah, happy birthday. Yeah, thank you. I think we'll stop these birthday wishes. We'll get into the topic. Thank you, Prashant. Okay, I'm sharing my presentation now. another half a minute only. Yeah. So today, the another important topic, the valuation of assets. That's the most important subject for all the civil engineers. Probably civil engineers are the only people who estimate the cost before construction and who value that project after construction also. So it's a very, very important topic today. I'll be talking about valuation of assets. So the overview of the topic is introduction, and I will explain who are the valuers and valuation need for valuation methods, and sample reports of valuation done by our company. So what is an asset valuation basically? An asset valuation is a method of assessing the worth of a company, real property, security, antique, or other items of worth. Asset validation is commonly performed prior to the sale of an asset. Validation and valuation are prior to purchasing insurance of an asset. So there are so many needs for this valuation actually. Why we have to value the asset. What is an asset actually? Asset is something that has a value, you know. It's an asset. We have assets and liabilities, every individual. So you have a house, you have a land, you have an agricultural land, you have a company, you have a business, you have a brand. Brand also is an asset. We have seen Amitabh Bachchan, ABC Corporation valued at 300 crores as value of Amitabh Bachchan. So asset can be anything that can be valued, you know, that can be exploited to realize some returns, you know. That is the asset. And what is the value of an asset? So there are so many methods of valuation which I'll be sharing today. And the value of asset is a realizable value for a person who is owning the asset. So sometimes it is highly relative and dependent on so many factors. Just give me a minute. I'll close the door. I'm getting disturbed. Sorry. So I had many experiences but today, of course, we'll be talking about the asset that is real estate, the construction asset, the constructed asset, and the land asset. We are concerned as civil engineers with these assets, but still we have to understand the other assets also. Being civil engineers, what is the asset, a company as an asset, because we as individuals also, we need to know our value, our company value, and how it can be valued. I had an experience when I had the land. Liability is like a loan. Loan is a liability. You take a loan on the asset, then you have a liability for the asset also. So that is a liability. So net value of the asset is asset value minus liability is the net value for the person. But for the person who is buying, it is overall cost. For the person who is selling, asset value is value of asset minus liability he has against that asset. So that is the liability. I'll share you with you one example of my own case where I wanted to sell a land and clear the loan I had, but there are no buyers for the land. So then what is the value of that land when there are no buyers? So the value of asset depends on the demand in the market. And similarly, at that time, I wanted to sell my company to clear the debt so that I can retain the asset, because instead of losing the asset at lower value, you always try to sell an asset that has better value than you expect. So that is the valuation of asset actually. So that is the method, my personal experience. The company that we cannot sell has no value. The land that we cannot sell has no value. So there is a value. Again, 1 minute, please. Yeah, sorry. So there is a value for any asset only when there is a taker, you know, that is the thing. So we have to consider all these risk factors when we do the valuation, whether we will be able to realize the value that we are assessing. And there is a risk, you know, for the risk also we have to create the insurance. In fact, we are conducting a webinar next Saturday on this risk in construction projects and professional indemnity. That is also available in the Facebook, you can see. So breaking down the asset valuation. Asset valuation may consist of both subjective and objective measurements. Normally in real estate, we have two components, both subjective and objective. The subjective is the construction value, you know, it is a subjective value. Nobody can differ on the value of brickwork, value of concrete, value of steel, value of flooring, and all that. Only thing is the method of applying depreciation may vary. Objective is land, actually. The land value depends on the buyer's need, actually, buyer's need. And similarly, the company is an objective value, actually. The people who want to buy a company may have a better value for the company than the person who is selling. When a person will sell the company, when he cannot service, when the asset becomes non-performing for him, he'll try to sell that company, you know. So there is no number on the company's financial statement that tell how much its brand name is worth, you know. Like today, we are seeing Reliance. Reliance brand name is so much valued actually, because they are successful in business. But suddenly it may fall with one mistake, by promoters or anybody, the company's values have fallen by 100 times also sometimes. So that is the objective value actually. So always the physical assets are the one which will have the real value, but physical asset also depends on market demand, real estate supply. Today you in the COVID circumstances, we have seen the real estate values falling down by 50%. So whenever we do the valuation, we should always consider this risk. So there is a distress value always for a property. What is the minimum value that a property can be assessed? So sometimes net profit is also subject to thing. A company making profit, you can assess the value of the company. So norm in the industry, financial markets is, it is always, for a service industry, the valuation can go up to 10 times. We are seeing the Zoom company, for example. The Zoom company value has grown tenfold, you know, because of the COVID, because everybody wants Zoom meeting software. So the users have jumped, and so the value has jumped. If you see Facebook, if you see Google, all these companies have no physical assets. It is all the service asset value. So technology will have higher value always. So this is just introduction about this valuation. So the common methods of including assets value is comparing it to similar assets and evaluating its cash flows, potential acquisition cost, replacement cost, and deprival value, depreciation, that means, are also methods of asset valuation. Assets are valued using absolute value, relative value, or option pricing models. which require different inputs actually. I'll not, this is a general description and definition of the valuation. And the process of registration as, now let us come to our point. Most of the civil engineers are valuers. There is a valuers association in our country, civil engineers and valuers association of India. There is an association which is very active, operating from Punjab. And one can register as a valuer in IBBI, you know, that is the act recently that has come, insolvency for banks and all. It is very important. It is not that everybody has to register as a valuer. Every civil engineer who has the experience of valuing can register as a valuer. So I'll be explaining that. Satisfy yourself that you meet the eligibility requirement prescribed in Rule 3 and the qualification and experience prescribed in Rule 4 of the IBBI. You can also, so thereafter seek enrollment as a valuer member of registered valuer organization. It can be a company, it can be an individual. So you have to be a registered valuer if you want to be officially recognized by these banks, insolvency. Nowadays, you know, NCLT is there. So if you want to be certified valuer, you have to register under IBBI rules actually. So can a valuer do valuation work without registration? With effect from February 1st, only registered valuers can undertake valuation under the Companies Act and the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code. However, any registered, unregistered person may continue to render valuation services under any other law which has not stipulated requirement of valuation to be undertaken by registered valuers. So, insurance companies have separate registered valuers, and the income tax department has got registered valuers. I'll be sharing all that details as we move forward. So we have income tax registered valuer, NCLT, IBBI registered valuer. We have distressed assets, that is auction. When the banks call for auction, the people who want to participate in auction also, they will take the valuation, distressed value of the asset. And liquidation of the assets, then also it is a value separately. And a person who wants to start a business, he wants to get the valuation of the assets. And distressed value, always banks ask for distressed value, you know, because when they're taking a particular asset as a collateral and funding, there will be a distressed value, because when the bank has to auction the property, it is under distressed condition of the asset. So we have to also consider this distressed value while we are giving the valuation of an asset. And government value versus market value. This is another big anomaly in our country. There will be government notified values. Some of the properties are notified some 2 decades back and they are not updated. So now we have a Land Acquisition Act 2013, which says that land should be acquired forcibly if it is required by the government by notification, by paying 3 times the market value. It's not the 3 times the government value. So for the people to be encouraged to part with their property, this is the, so how do you assess the market value? So market value, you have to inquire. So there will be a certified valuer who will give the market value. Income tax registered valuer or IBBA registered valuer only can give in such cases the value of the land. So the biggest valuation that we have done is when Satyam Computers was to be sold. Tech Mahindra has taken over this company, and overnight we had to give the valuation. Fortunately, because we had the experience of working on all these projects, we know what are the assets available in that properties, whether it is in Hyderabad, Vizag, and all that. Bhujangarao is there in this session. Probably he can vouch for me. He was in Satyam Computers at that time, and after that Tech Mahindra. So overnight we had to give valuation of assets of about 5,000 crores. So that is the biggest experience we had and the best experience we had in giving the valuation of the property, you know. So as a company, because we were the consultants, we are the consultants even now for this company. So we have to be aware of all these valuation principles and assets, whether it is land value or construction value. So civil engineers are expected to know. So now we are getting into the topic. The process of estimating the market value of a financial asset or liability is the valuation, actually. It can be a financial asset, doesn't mean only fixed deposit or shares. It can be physical asset also, fixed assets, movable assets. Movable assets are cars and all that. And fixed machinery, construction machinery is a movable asset in the construction. And financial asset is shares and value of the company, that they are the financial assets. And so liability also we have to consider whenever we do the valuation of the. So liability is an obligation, debt or responsibility owed to someone. So we have to be very careful in assessing the. So we have to conduct the due diligence of the property, you know, the any encumbrance of the property is there. Encumbrance is created like mortgage, you know, loan against property people will take and all that. So asset is something or someone of any value, any portion of one's property or effects so considered. That is the value of an asset. So basic asset valuation in finance, valuation is the process of estimating what something is worth. And items that are usually valued are a financial asset or a liability. Valuations can be done on assets, investments, market securities, stock options, business enterprises, so in or intangible assets. So let us understand what are the tangible and intangible assets. Tangible asset is land, tangible asset is building. So that cannot be questioned by anyone. Intangible are the turnover, the brand value, all these are intangible assets, you know, and trademarks. That is royalty that is receivable over a period and all. And liabilities are bonds issued by a company. Valuations are needed for so many reasons, such as investment analysis, capital budgeting, merger and acquisition transactions, which we have done as I mentioned, and financial reporting, taxable events to determine the property tax liability, and in litigation. Yes, it becomes a liability. Like for example, the property values fall down, but you have to keep paying the property tax. That's a asset becomes a liability. You don't earn any money out of the property, but you have to keep paying the property tax. I remember, in early 20th century, I was told my grandfather had to sell the land to pay the tax on the property. They have sold at least 20 acres of land to pay the property tax. You know, that is a liability. The asset has become a liability then. Unless you sell, you can't pay the tax. So it's a very good question somebody asked me. That is Neelkant Thakur. Yeah, that's a good point actually. So asset becomes a liability when the taxes are higher than the value itself. So it's better you dispose of the asset and clear the liability. So purpose of valuation is purchasing for investment, purchasing for self-occupation, revision of capitals. That means you can reassess your share value by assessing your assets, you know. Because there is inflation, particularly in our country, the rupee value is falling. Every year on year, 7 to 8% inflation is going on. So the lands which were, 10,000 rupees some 40 years back, is today 4 crores, same acre of land. So imagine how much. So your asset value has increased, but you have not revised your capital valuation. So you have to do the valuation for your asset. And interim reports of execution, buildings or other structures. Like banks, when they're funding, they want the valuation report of the construction progress and all that certified by engineers. So we also will be giving interim reports for execution of buildings, wherein also the valuation is required. Compensation of land acquisition. Nowadays, you know, whether it is highways or canals, irrigation projects, the government has to acquire the land. So for that land acquisition, they need the market value, because they have to compensate 3 times the market value of the property. And the present value of the old properties also people will be taking. And in arbitration also people will be going for valuation actually. So purpose of valuation is assessing property tax also. You have to wealth tax, you know, most of the people don't pay in our country. In fact, there is a method of assessing wealth tax. If you own assets more than one house, and if you own cars also, you have to pay the wealth tax, but nobody pays, unfortunately, in our country. Income tax also, for valuation of income tax. When you purchase the property, if you are registered for lesser value, so income tax may ask a valuer to give the valuation of the asset and ask you to pay the tax. Whoever has sold also should pay the tax. And you know, nowadays you have to pay tax deducted at source of 1% for the property you are selling. So all this is there. Gift tax also, if you have gifted, for example, a father gifts land to his son, then it is a gift, it attracts gift tax. So for that also government may ask for valuation. Capital gains also require valuation, you know. So you have sold a property which you are owning for 30 years. 30 years back you bought the property, today you are selling. So you will get a capital gain, long-term capital gain. Sometimes if you sell within 2 years, you will get a short-term capital gain. So for selling also you take valuation, for mortgaging you take valuation, for collateral security you take valuation, and for auctioning banks, when they put a particular property for valuation, for keeping the starting value, they will take the valuation from the registered valuer of the banks. So insurance, when you take insurance for a particular property, fire, against fire or against theft or anything, you have to take the valuation, because the premium of insurance depends on the value of the property. Suppose you have a property worth 1 crore and you want to insure for 5 crores. Insurance company won't simply insure for that 5 crore value. They will take the valuation report and ask you to insure for the realistic value, market value. And the court fee and stamps. For example, there is a litigation on a property, you go for filing a case in court, then also court fee is assessed based on the value of the property. So there also you have to take the valuation. Partitions, suppose the father has written a will for partitioning the property equally to his sons, then automatically people will go for valuation, how to partition the property. Stamp duty, government, when you are registering a property, to pay the stamp duty, you need to have the valuation. Rent fixation. For a rent fixation also, you have to go for valuation of the asset, because there is some method for fixing the rent, that is 0.6% per month of the asset value should be the reasonable rent for any asset. And different kinds of properties. Now let us look at land and buildings, which we deal with as civil engineers. Agricultural lands, coffee, tea, rubber plantations, forests, mines and quarries. That is the biggest thing. We are seeing biggest scams in mines and quarries. And stocks, shares and debentures, not connected to us, but we should also be aware of this as individuals. And plant and machinery. This normally, plant and machinery assessment is done by mechanical engineers. They are eligible to. And jewelry, of course, we are not connected with it. And works of art and craft. This also we are not connected, but this is also an asset. So valuation of financial assets, I will not go into the details. I will probably skip all these slides so that I can spend more meaningful time. Future cash flows. There are different methods of valuations. Profit end in the last 3 years, 5 years. Projected cash flows, projected profit. EBITDA, that is called. Earnings before depreciation and tax applied. EBITDA also is one method, EBITDA model. And profit after tax also is another model. So these are all the things as civil engineers we should profit from short term and long term investments also. So fair value is used accordance with the US GAAP So there is an agreement. It's not that every country can value their assets as they like. So there is an international agreement among the countries on the method of valuation. So common terms for the value of an asset or liability are fair market value, fair value, and intrinsic value. These meanings of different terms differ. For instance, when an analyst believes a stock's intrinsic value is greater than its market price, an analyst makes buy. So buy or sell depends on this intrinsic value. If there is an intrinsic value which is higher than actual market value, you better buy. If the intrinsic value is lesser than actual market value, you better sell it off. You are getting better value. So these are all the things we should know. So appraised value. So when, just a minute. When a plant asset purchase for cash, its acquisition cost is simply the agreed cash. And however, when business acquires plant assets in exchange for other non, nowadays we are getting this valuation requirements. People are acquiring, one company is acquiring schools. So they wanted a valuation of the schools. One company is acquiring a running plant, oil mill. So they have approached us for valuation, condition assessment of the structure and valuation of that structure. So sometimes neither of the items exchanged has really determinable fair market value. Then accountants record exchanges of items at their appraised value as determined by a professional appraiser. So an appraised value is an expert's opinion of an item's fair market price of the item. So this is all economics and finance terminology, which is difficult for us to understand, but we should know. Please read this. I'll not read it for you, but the book value is also very important. So in the companies, suppose you buy a computer, the depreciation applied is 20% per annum. So computer you buy for 1 lakh rupees every year, its value, book value reduces by 20%. Sometimes the computer value may go up. Steel, for example, we buy the steel value is going up. We bought steel some 10 years back, 25,000 rupees, and if you can't apply depreciation on that. So, but as an asset, building depreciation can be applied, but building intrinsic value will be higher because steel is there, which is an asset. So like that, we have to take the book value of every item and for valuation actually. Finance valuation, I will not explain. Business valuation also, it is a job of chartered accountants and not the engineers. And discounted cash flow method and guideline companies method. And these are all things I skip. And valuation of a suffering company, valuation of a startup company. This nowadays, we have a lot of startups and we have to project the business feasible and possible with that startup technology. Valuation of intangible assets. This is what is happening nowadays. Most of the technology-based companies, operation and maintenance is a liability actually. So we have to reduce that value of O&M on the asset value. How do you value your company? To determine the book value, subtract your liabilities from the value of your assets, and the difference gives you net worth of our shareholders' equity. In practice, book value is seldom used in the process of securing venture capital. Yeah, we have to follow the IBBI guidelines. IBBI has published the guidelines for valuation. So it depends. Income tax method is different. Banks method is different. IBBI method is different. So whenever we are doing valuation, we should understand the need of valuation and do that valuation following that process defined. With an asset is an example of valuation account that is associated with an asset is the allowance for doubtful accounts. Accounts also can be fudged. We have seen companies collapsing because of fudged accounts. And business valuation of mining projects, this we have to know the value of minerals and the quantum of mineral that is possible, that there are specialists who will assess the total quantum of mining possibility. We have to consider the royalty for the mining and arrive at the value of the mine and cost of mining also. Yeah, methods of valuation of assets. So we have a cost method, we have a market value method, we have replacement value method, we have net realizable value method, and then base stock method, and a standard cost method, and average cost method. These are all the methods of valuation of assets, and we will not go into these details because it's not connected with construction. I'll better concentrate on construction valuation. So financial statements prepared in accordance. So incentive in finance comes. So I'm skipping all this. Please note, I'm not explaining financial valuations because that's not our job. Lack of control, there are adjustments, working capital adjustments and all. The standards spearheaded by stress assets, and what is the value of an asset? Net asset value. This is, you should know this net asset value. In fact, recently I used this net asset value method. I want to sell flats, 1,000 flats in the coming 5 years, let us say. So I will, end of 5 years, I am projecting a total value of 40 crores, let us say, approximate. So if we are 400 crores, let us say, what is its current asset value today? How much I can sell if somebody pays me the whole money today? No, there is no cap for the valuers, but experience will determine. Suppose if you are expected to do 1,000 crore valuation, a person who has done so far only 10 lakh rupees valuation cannot do definitely 1,000 crores. So then you should have that experience of 400 crores, you know, valuation. So that is the range you should have that experience. Experience is considered. So net asset value is, method of net asset value is you take the compounding interest rate at 8% per annum, for example, and arrive at today. So for 400 crores net asset in 5 years, quarterly rest, we have got a net asset value of 240 crores today. So you can buy that asset at 240 crores by paying upfront money. That means if you borrow the money at 8%, at the end of 5 years, you are paying only 400 crores. So this is very important. You should know the net asset value method, NAV. And business valuation, we don't asset approach, market approach, income approach. This is the important for buildings also. We do the asset approach. That means what is the cost of building, cost of land, and we value the asset based on that cost. And market approach is what is the marketable value of that particular asset. And income approach is how much income people can earn on that asset. These are the different approaches that we consider. And asset approach is business as a set of assets and liabilities that are used as building stocks to construct the picture of business value. What will it cost to create another business like this one? And this is market approach is the as the name implies, relies on signs from the real marketplace. So when we take market approach, we have to consider all the risk factors of the market in the future. Today it is very uncertain. If somebody takes market approach today, we don't know how long this COVID will remain. 3 months, 6 months, suddenly after 1 month it may get back to normal, or it may take another 1 year to get back to normal. So it's very difficult, risky to take market approach now. Income approach also. Now we are seeing a lot of properties getting vacated, whether it is office or residential and all. There is a lot of change in the market dynamics. So it is very difficult to take this market approach and income approach at this stage. Now, as consultant, as engineers, what are the critical factors for asset, land and building? This is the core of our topic today. Any asset, any land, when we are valuing, its location is very important. Access to the land. Can you take your car into the site? That is the access. And the connectivity. Can you reach that place by transport, public transport, whether it is a bus or train or metro? What is its connectivity? Shape of the land. That means if you have a what you call oblong site, that means 20 feet by 1,000 feet site, that value will be very less, you know, because it is oblong. And the level and gradient, sometimes you have a hilly terrain, and its value will be different because you can't construct very easily on a hilly terrain. But you have a plain ground or you have a gradient site, they are good actually. And then abutting condition of the road, abutting road condition, abutting road width, existing width and proposed width. Then sometimes there will be master plan, the road width that you have may be only 30 feet and in master plan it may be 60 feet. That means you have to leave 15 feet of the road. You may get compensation for the road width, road widening, or you may get TDR, transferable development right, for the road you say. So all these things we have to consider in the valuation. Land use. What is the land use zone in the master plan in of that particular land? You have to check the land use certificate from the urban development authority or corporation. It can be residential, it can be commercial, it can be multi-use, it can be mixed use development, or it can be conservation, it can be institutional, it can be buffer zone. So we have to check that land use of that particular site. And is that site prone to flooding? Also we have to verify. So these are all the technical parameters we have to check while we are valuing. So please note, these things are very important. Location, access, connectivity, shape, level and gradient, abutting existing condition, width of the road, and land use. So normally a valuer has to take the photographs of all these factors and document it when he is giving the valuation. Master plan. So master plan is notified always for every city, for a given survey number, for a given location of the land, what is its use and what is the road width that is going to be. And availability of power, water, drainage also will influence the value of the property. So we have to check proximity or availability of power nearest substation and what is its capacity. Sometimes, otherwise you have to pay for upgradation of power. If there is no power, sometimes you have to spend 2-3 crores for getting the power itself. Similarly, water. And you know, one project we did, high-rise building, in that zone, there was no fire station. So we had to pay for setting a fire station also, because we don't get the high-rise building permission if you don't have fire station, or they will ask you to set up all that in your site. So we have to consider all these: availability of power, water, and drainage. Will you be able to connect your drainage? Next is the floor space index or floor area ratio and fly zone. You know, the height of the building is controlled by fly zone. Is your site closer to any airport or Air Force Academy? You have to consider, you have to take the no objection certificate from that airport authority or defense people. So defense neighbors also you have to check, because there is a defense neighbor restrictions. If you are close to defense property, your valuation will be lesser actually, up to 500 meters. And railway affecting, if your property is close to railway line, also you have to take NOC from railway affecting, and they will put a lot of restrictions on the property construction. You can't easily construct if your property is railway affecting. So conservation zones, buffer zones, CRZ, you know, the sea, near the sea. We have seen recently some 25-storied, 40-storied building being demolished in Cochin, Kerala, because they have not taken the NOC from CRZ. What is the value of that building then? It is a construction rubble. That's it, value. No concrete value, no steel value. So land use restrictions, you have to check all this when we are giving the valuation. Development cost, what is the cost of development? For example, if you are buying a bare land, in a bare land, if you do the plotting, the plotted area you get will be less, and the development cost of roads, providing water, providing drainage, and all will cost. So development cost we have to take into consideration for that land. Suppose it is a marshy land, the development cost will be very high. Even to lay the roads, even to fill the land, you have to do a lot of ground improvement. So we have to factor that. And neighborhood development, we have to also consider what is available in the surroundings of the property when we are valuing. And social infrastructure, availability of social, even like temple or a graveyard or a all the social infrastructure required and entertainment and recreation, schools, colleges, availability of school, because nowadays the proximity to schools is enhancing the value. Suppose in Hyderabad we have Kondapur is a place where there was a Chirak public school initially. Just because of that school, people want to live nearer to the school for the children. So in the United States also, I was told the properties near in the proximity to school have a very high value. And similarly, colleges availability and hospitals, availability of hospital healthcare is most important. So you have to check the, these are all the things we have to mention in our valuation report. And the hotel, recreation, sports, also is part of basic infrastructure for any development to happen. So, and the commercial activity nearby, like shops, hypermarts and all that, you should have the commercial activity, malls, multiplexes, that kind of stuff also will determine the value. And employment opportunities also will determine the value of the property. Growth in the area and the city, how it is going to. So we'll take the past 10 years growth of the city and what will be the future growth can be predicted. And proposed growth corridors. Nowadays, you know, industrial growth corridors are happening like Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor, Chennai-Bangalore industrial corridor, like that Vizag side, AP also industrial corridor, Noida industrial corridor. So like that, there are industrial corridors proposed. So such industrial corridors will also enhance the value of the property falling in those corridors. And general land development in the area. And state political stability. This is very important while considering the valuation. And the construction cost. Any building that we have to consider the construction cost of that building. Utilities. What are the utilities like power, water, fire, and amenities? And amenities are clubhouse, recreation facilities, children's play area, sports facilities, and all that. Parking, with the value of the parking, that sometimes you have to build parking at a separate place for the commercial use and all that. And fire safety and firefighting. That also has a cost. We have to assess the value of fire safety if it is available. And we have to add the cost of fire safety if it is not available. Security and access control. Compound wall, security wall, gate, entrance gate. All these also add to the value. Access control, that is surveillance, security surveillance, CC camera availability and all that. And the civil and structural cost. What is the cost of a structure? If it is a multi-storied building, if it is a normal ground plus one building, there is a valuation difference. Plumbing and sanitary, the condition of plumbing and sanitary, the type of fixtures that are there in plumbing also will add to the value. Stormwater disposal, harvesting also, we have to check whether there is a stormwater disposal or rainwater harvesting available for the site. Electrical and building automation, electrical facilities, electrical fixtures, appliances, electrical appliances like diesel generator and all. Elevators and escalators, they have a cost. And interior finishes like flooring, false ceiling, wall cladding, wall finishing, all this will we have to consider the valuation. Suppose Italian marble is there, its value is 200 rupees, 300 rupees per square feet. If it is normal marble, it is 100 rupees. Granite is 150 rupees. Like that, if it is a normal cement flooring, it is 10 rupees per square feet. That kind of valuation we have to consider. And a facade. External facade, also we have to measure the area of external facade treatment, whether it is aluminum cladding or glazed cladding, we have to consider the value of this facade. And landscaping available, what is the hardscape available and what is the softscape landscaping available. Driveways, availability of driveways, and if it is a high-rise building, driveway, whether it is designed for fire tender movement or not. Air conditioning, is it available and what kind of air conditioning it is? Central air conditioning or split air conditioners or type of air conditioning also has got the value. And it's the age of air conditioning system that is provided. And the signage, facade lighting also has got the value we have to assess. So finally, somebody is asking me, what is the plotted yield nowadays considering the bylaws? It varies actually bylaws from place to place. We have to consider the bare land cost, and a plotted yield. Suppose you have 1 acre. 1 acre of land can yield 2,000 square yards of plotted yield or 2,500 square yards of plotted yield. Plot size also will determine the plotted yield. Large plot size will give you more plotted area, and smaller plot size will give you lesser plotted area, because you have to provide roads for and road widths also vary from urban area to urban area. And the land development cost per square yard, normally, or per square meter we take, is varying from 400 rupees to 4,000 rupees per square yard. Suppose just you want to provide basic water supply as per the urban body norms, and just you want to sell the plots, then it may cost minimum 400 rupees you have to provide for. That is a property fencing, access gate, entrance gate, roads, and power cables, like distribution lines, power distribution lines, water supply lines, and overhead tank, water storage, underground storage, and water supply, all will cost about 400 rupees per square yard. That means 10 lakh rupees per acre will be the 10 lakh rupees per acre will be the cost of development, approximately minimum. To it can go up to 1 crore rupees per acre. So this is the cost, and the building cost is can be valued anything between 1,000 rupees to 6,000 rupees. The highest building that I have shared the parameters just before, all like air conditioning, escalators, elevators, and facade glazing, and good flooring, all that if you have, the cost of construction including the parking will be about 1,000 rupees to 6,000 rupees per square meter. And the other breakup of finishes and facade, we have to take into consideration depending on the finish, type of finishes and type of facade. And cost of mechanical, electrical, plumbing, and automation. Nowadays, every building has got the automation. So we have to specifically assess the available utilities and amenities in the project for valuation. So valuation of a building depends on the type of the building, its structure, and durability. Like what is the life of the structure so far, and what is the residual life of the structure? Will it require any retrofitting because codes are changing? On the situation, size, shape, frontage, width of roadways, the quality of materials used in the construction. Sometimes we even do the non-destructive testing to assess the condition of the building, to give the valuation. Valuation also depends on the height of the building, height of the plinth, thickness of the wall, nature of the floor, roof, doors, windows, etc. The valuation of building is determined on working out its cost of construction at present day rate and allowing a suitable depreciation. In fact, we suppose the building is 30 years old, you cannot take the value of 30 years back and then apply depreciation. That's not allowed. We have to take today's value and apply depreciation for 30 years, and that will be the replacement cost, that is called. So we have to do that. So six methods of valuation is rental method of valuation, direct comparisons of the capital value. That means you estimate the cost of construction today and apply the depreciation depending on the age of the building, and then get the net value, capital value of the building. And the value of the land you can assess based on the market inquiries. And valuation based on the profit, that normally we don't do, but for properties like hotels, and amusement parks and all, we assess based on the profit, because they have only that application, or a hospital. There, the construction value has no meaning, actually. For that location, is hospital running very well? Somebody will be willing to pay better for that hospital, so we have to consider the profit-based valuation. And valuation based on the cost, that I have explained, cost of construction and land value, actually. And development method of valuation, that means current day, the land may be bare land. You should not take the bare land cost. We have to consider the cost of development, and then what is its enhanced value. That also we take. Depreciation method of valuation, I explained. So rental method of valuation is, suppose we are valuing an office building. The office building is giving you a rental value of 30 rupees per square feet per month, let us say. 30 rupees per square feet per month is the value. You take Yeah, civil engineers can do the valuation, and civil engineers can register as a valuer. And qualification and experience, I have mentioned in the beginning, you can see there is a rule 3 and 4 of IBBI. In the website it is given, you can see that and register as a valuer. So rental method of valuation is we take 8 years rental value as the current, and take the net asset value today. That is how we take value of the asset. So that means if you have 30 rupees, normally the value of asset can be 6,000 rupees approximately. That's how we take 30 rupees per month will be 6,000 rupees per square feet is the value of asset. So that means 0.6% is the rental value applied. And a direct comparison with the capital value. You verify in the surrounding areas how people are selling the value of that property, and then you can arrive at the comparison of capital value. And valuation based on profit, this I explained, how much profit you are getting, and based on that, we take, based on the turnover, there will be 5x, 4x kind of value of that asset actually. Valuation based on cost, that we assess the cost of construction today and then apply the depreciated value and then arrive at the net value of the asset today. Development method of valuation. Sometimes, yeah, this is, I have an example. One client approached me. He said his value is 200 crores. But if you verify in the market there, it is only 100 crores. But the client wanted a valuation of 200 crores. How do you arrive at the 200 crores valuation? What I did is I took this development method of valuation. When I suppose you, the landowner gives that property for development, what is the value he will expect out of the development? You know, there is a outright sale and there is a development come GPA. There are two methods of selling the property. So development method, when we take, the value will be higher than market value today. But development takes some time, 3 years, 4 years. So what we do is we take the development value realization of after 4 years and take the net asset value today. I did it, and I took a lot of time convincing the bankers actually to take that value, but ultimately I could convince. So this is another method that you can take, development method of valuation. And if a building is required to be renovated by making additional changes, alteration, so we have to take the valuation of walls, valuation of roof, flooring and doors and windows, joinery type and all that. And the cost of each part should be worked out and then present the rates by detailed measurements. Even you have to take the measurement of the flooring, measurement of the wall, everything we have to take, and take the present value of replacement cost. So land and building method, rent capitalization method, development method, profit method, direct comparison method. So these are all the methods of valuation we will be doing. And land and building method is you take the land value of the in the surroundings, and that is the land value to be assessed. And building method is building cost. We have to take today's cost and then apply the depreciation for the building. And calculate either by straight line method or linear method. Both are similar actually. And rental or capitalization method is, I explained this also, consists of capitalizing the net annual rental income at an appropriate rate of interest or rate of capitalization. So this is the method. For example, I'll tell you, 30 rupees is the rent per month. That means per year, how much is the rent per square feet? 3,600. How much rent you can earn in 8 years? That is how we take normally. 8 years rent is 24,000. You will get the value of the rent, total value. 360 rupees per annum at 30 rupees, and 8 years is 2,400 rupees, 2,800 rupees, and plus land value appreciation and all we have to apply. That's how I said it will come to 6,000 rupees of the asset value actually per square feet of that asset value. So net annual rent income equals to gross annual rental income minus outgoing property tax. So normally property tax is 20%, and maintenance and service charges also will be about 4 rupees, 5 rupees per square feet, and insurance premium. We have to pay the insurance also, premium for risk, you know, and the rent collection and management charges. That also will be about 5 to 10%. So you deduct all that, you get the net rent. I am always talking about net rent only 30 rupees when I said, that means gross rent may be about 40 rupees. Development method, I explained this also, the residual method, profit method also I explained, and the general procedure to do valuation of the building, measure the plinth area, observe the specifications and other factors which affect the value, adopt suitable replacement rate of construction for the building portion alone, and multiply the plinth area by the unit rate to get the replacement value of the building. Ascertain the age of the building. Normally, the thumb rule that we take is 1/3. If you can assess the structural cost, if you can, or if you can assess the finishes cost, it is 3 times the value. So always in any building, the valuation goes like this: 30% towards structure, civil and structure, 30% for facade and finishes, 30% for MEP, 90%, 10% is other things which you can add always. So total value of the building you can always assess. If you are spending 1,000 rupees on structure, that means it's a commercial building. If you are spending 600 rupees per structure, that is a residential building. So for a residential building, it will cost 1,800 rupees, and for a commercial building, it will cost 3,000 rupees. This is my thumb rule, that is the valuation you can do. But always you better check, of course, this is a thumb rule, as I said, you can consider. Estimate suitable total life of the building. Normally the life of building to be taken is 50 years, and if it has already served 30 years, the remaining residual building value is 20% only, 20 years only. And then, so these are the valuation of assets. Assume suitable percentage for salvage value. Calculate depreciation by straight line method, and depreciation percentage is equal to age by total life. That means 30 years by 50 years. That is 60% will be the remaining value is 40%. And if the age is not known, if the building has crossed its life, estimate future life and calculate the depreciation. Sometimes we can propose retrofitting to increase the life of the structure and take the cost of retrofitting and then take the enhanced value and arrive at the net value of the building also. So present value is equal to replacement value minus depreciation value. So this is the value of the building, and add suitable depreciated value for other works like amenities, extra works and all. So in this method, the valuation of building portions being valued separately after allowing depreciation and the land is valued separately and then added to get the present value of the property. So value of the building plus value of the land plus value of the amenities and services. That is the present value of the property. And procedure for valuation is ascertain from applicant the exact purpose of valuation, number one, very important point. And from the document available, note down the measurement of the plot and details, and verify the measurements and the extents of the site, and verify whether it is according to the document or not, and then assess suitable unit rate based on prevailing market rate or from the recent comparable sale instances of a similar vacant plot. Arrive at the value of the building by adopting the procedure. Additional value of the land building will be the present value of the property. If the aim of valuation is to assess market value, apply the reduction factor of the value of the land, add suitable percentage towards the potential value, deduct any percentages towards negative factors, analyze any other points depending on individual merits of the case, and give valuation report in the appropriate format. This is the procedure for valuation. So this again, definition of cost. What is the cost? Cost is a fact actually. We cannot dispute. Already there is a transaction at a cost. So that's not disputable. It is a fact actually. If you have a documentary proof that this is the cost, that is the cost. Price is based on the policy. That is a government value, is a price. And value is, it is an opinion actually. So valuer gives an opinion. Let us all remember, it is not the cost. Value is not cost, value is not the price. Value is an opinion of a valuer. So it always depends on place, date and purpose of valuation. This is what every valuer should remember. the place, date, and purpose. So I'll be showing you some of the valuation reports example. Please don't take. So this is a valuation done in 2003. So high class, centrally located with all amenities. This is a house value which we have done. And so we give all the details after, and there will be annexure with all the details of finishes and all. Valuation certificate for premises in another property. So this is also, we have given a report like this. And this is only top report actually. There will be details annexed with photographs and measurements and estimate, all that. So this is these are all the examples. And construction cost evaluation details and specifications. This is the bore well, everything we give and give the value. So these are all the examples. I have shared it in the in the box drive of Facebook page. So if you can refer to these examples, because we ran out of the time. Today I had difficulty in managing my time. So that's why I'm not able to spend time on these examples. I should have spent more time on these examples, but definitely you will be able to read and understand this. I've shared it in PDF. So I'll take one or two questions if you have any, and then conclude. So these are all the examples. So I had some questions. Can civil engineer do valuation? Yeah, civil engineers can do valuation of land and building. They're allowed to do. Can a chartered engineer work as a valuer? Yes, many banks ask for certification of a chartered engineer. In fact, chartered engineer is given by institution of engineers. So you can become a chartered engineer. And also, if the land and building is in the vicinity of famous actor, yeah, that's right. How much percentage of plot is developable? This I answered. 45% to 55% of the land will be a developed plot. And what is the minimum experience required to become a valuer? In fact, I think it is about 5 years is the experience required. You better work under a valuer and do valuation of some assets, then you get the experience, relevant experience. That is very important. There is a cap, yeah, always relevant valuation is important. And guidelines are by different departments, income tax, bank, and IBBI. You should follow the guidelines. And operation and maintenance cost also need to be calculated before buying an asset. Yeah, that's right. That is important. And profit from short, long-term investment also is considered in the valuation. Can an asset become liability? Yeah, this also I explained. Thank you very much. So these are all the questions, I think. And insurance of building to be done on book value or market value? It depends, actually. It is always better to do it on market value. But as per Income Tax Act and banks, you have to do based on the book value. So these are the things. So thank you very much. This will be textbook for fresh values. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah. So thank you all for wishing me on my birthday as per Telugu calendar. And we'll meet on Monday again. Monday is the next lecture. Minimum experience required for chartered engineer. Yeah. That you refer to Institution of Engineers guidelines. So thank you very much. I'll conclude my talk today and we'll meet on Monday.